you have done with your first big board for the 2022 NFL Draft. Mel, let's dive right into your top three prospects. And I should note, these are your top three prospects for right now. Let's start at number three.
Number three is Derek Stingley Jr. out of LSU. As a freshman, 6 interceptions, 9 pass breakups, a lockdown corner, great versatility, best since Patrick Peterson. Patrick Peterson was number one on my board when he came out. Never had a cornerback go number one, though, but on rating, Patrick Peterson was there. I thought Derek Stingley Jr. could be there at number one. Then he fell back as a sophomore last year. No picks. Beaten some. Now this is the year to bounce back and revert back to that freshman form. If he does, he's going to be certainly one of the first players selected. Maybe not number one. We never had a cornerback, but he's going to go very high. The guy who could maybe go number one because he's a quarterback is Spencer Rattler from Oklahoma. You watched him early last year, he looked like a late rounder. Yeah, watching the last 7 games, looked like a top 5 pick. And if he can build on that with the multiple tight ends, H-backs, with a strong running game, Oklahoma, I think, has a chance to win a national title if they do. And he's has great success. Spencer Rattler, because he's a quarterback, and Sam Howell, North Carolina, would be in this mix. He could go number one overall. But the guy I would bet on going number one overall, I think, is hands down the best player in this draft, and who was the best player coming out of high school, is Kayvon Thibodeau. What more can you ask of a defensive end? Myles Garrett went number one. Mario Williams went number one. Jadeveon Clowney went number one. We have had those, even Courtney Brown back in the day. So I think there's a great opportunity for Thibodeau to have a phenomenal year. He's a great kid. He works on his game. And if you don't need a quarterback, you take Kayvon Thibodeau. And maybe it's going to be Houston, and they would look at a quarterback. But if you want the best player in this draft, I think it's going to be Thibodeau, lock, stock, and barrel.
Well, Mel, you mentioned the Texans could be one of those teams picking early in the draft next year. Here's a look at the teams that have the highest chance of a top 5 pick in next year's draft. This is according to ESPN's Football Power Index. The Texans, who you mentioned, top of the list with a 66% chance, followed by the Lions and the Jets. Again, this is for a top 5 pick in the 2022 NFL draft. Reminder, Philly has up to 3 first-round picks. They're also on this list. So, Key, as we look forward to the college football season ahead, and the prospects that Mel just mentioned, which player are you most excited about?
It's Kayvon Thibodeau out of Oregon, a defensive end. I've watched him since high school. He originally started at Susan Miller Dorsey High, where I went. Then he went to Oaks Christian. So I've been following his entire career. The one thing that concerns me about him is developing a pass rush move. He hasn't gotten there quite. If he does, he could be a double-digit sack guy. But like Mel said, is he more Courtney Brown or is he more Myles Garrett? We don't know yet. He needs to develop into that, and I think he will at some point in time. He's a fine young man. He plays a little high at times. He's not afraid to take on the blockers in the run game. But on the pass side of things, Swaggoo, he needs to develop some pass rush moves for sure.
Yeah, no doubt. And his quickness lends itself to that, Key. But you're absolutely right. You see him using a lot of speed, the power, and especially the rip, dip, and rip move around the corner. And listen, for what he does it at a very high level. But to your point, when you get to the NFL, man, you're going to have to figure out how to go around guys, set up offensive linemen. And that's the challenge for every D lineman coming out of college. But he has the skill set and the tools to get it done. I want to talk about Derek Stingley Jr., though. And y'all know he's my LSU guy. And I want to see this dude back healthy. Last year, he didn't play as much as he played his freshman year. And he wasn't – remember this, too. A lot of times this guy will be judged on the few plays that he gets on his side. People always have to remember, when you have these type of elite level corners, the numbers don't talk about how good of a player they are because people stay away from them. He was fortunate a couple years ago to have Christian Fulton on the other side, who was another top tier corner. So people had to pick their poison, and he had a successful year with numbers. So Stingley Jr. coming back, he's a 6'1 corner. I said when he left LSU, he would be the best ever. Did not foresee his sophomore year going like it went. But I expect fully for him to, like, clearly, no one else close to assert himself as the number one cornerback coming out of the draft. And always, this is why I love to hear when Mel puts these guys on this big board. Because the way we look at the draft is not always about who the best guy is. It's sometimes about what team is picking in these first 3 to 4 to 5 picks. Like we had the conversation, Kyle Pitts was the best player in the draft last year. But Kyle Pitts ain't a quarterback, and Kyle Pitts fell to a team that already had a quarterback. I'm looking forward to seeing the defense reassert themselves in the first round. I was very disappointed in Mel's big boy last year.
You'll be happy this year, Marcus, because DeMarvin Leal is another kid out of Texas A&M. You talk about developing secondary moves. He needs a finish, and he will get more sacks. And DeMarvin Leal from Texas A&M will be right there, possibly, Marcus, with Thibodeau. And you're going to have a Kyle Hamilton, the safety at Notre Dame, way up there. There's going to be a lot of defensive players in this draft in the top 10. Certainly, a lot of questions. You could see six corners go in the first round. So I think it will be that type of draft. The quarterbacks always get forced up, as you guys know. Rattler's in a pretty good position. He's got a lot of talent around him. Sam Howell, though, at North Carolina. Looks like the next Baker Mayfield. He lost Javonte Williams, Michael Carter, two top running backs, and Daz Newsome and De'Ami Brown, two top receivers. How does he deal with those losses in North Carolina with the Tar Heels and Mack Brown for Sam Howell to maintain that high grade and challenge Spencer Rattler, or even a Malik Willis at Liberty? Could be a guy, a dual threat quarterback, had a phenomenal year at Liberty. Now he's back for year two. He puts up the numbers he did last year, both running and passing. Don't sleep on him as well in terms of the top part of the first round.
Yeah, Sam Howell has
some. What about Slovis,
do we have time
man?
To ask a question?
Where's Slovis at?
Go ahead, Swaggoo. Have at it. Why not?
I just wanted to ask Mel. Oh, go ahead. Go ahead and ask a key question, Mel.
Yeah, Slovis is one of about 6-7 quarterbacks, key, you could put in there. He's the same grade as a Carson Strong at Nevada, Jaden Daniels, Arizona State, Desmond Ridder, Cincinnati. There's a lot of quarterbacks vying for that third, fourth spot after even Malik Willis isn't guaranteed at Liberty. He's got to do what he did this past year, do it again this season. If he does, he's at three. That fourth spot is wide open. Like I said, there's JT Daniels at Georgia's in that mix. So if he has a year, I'm still a little questioning the three games against weak competition. Cincinnati Bearcats should have beat them. That game was mismanaged late, more from the coaches than the players. So I think when you look at the quarterbacks, it is a solid group. After that top three, Slovis is in that mix to maybe be a first-round pick. McShay, much higher on Slovis right now than I am, but I like Slovis. I just want to see him show that he's elite this year and maybe be above and beyond maybe what we've seen so far.
If you want to watch Sam Howell, by the way, one of the quarterbacks that Mel is high on, you can do so tomorrow night on ESPN, 6 p.m. Eastern time. No one loves a shameless plug more than I do. Coming up on NFL Live.